Good evening. I'm here to tell you how a group of kids from an inner city school in Phoenix can become one of the top robotics teams in the country. But before I do that, I've got to give you a little bit of background about the school. About 98% Hispanic, most of them on federally assisted lunch programs. A large percentage of them documented, undocumented, we don't know for sure, but we do know that there's a pretty good percentage of them that are undocumented. And a lot of them come to school without the academic level that you would expect that they would normally come to high school. So that's what we got coming into the school at Carl Hayden High School. And what we decided to do was create a way for them to experience learning a little different than what they normally do in a classroom setting. So it's what we, I guess the term is out there, extracurricular STEM. And the STEM stands for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. So we created this group of kids, and we signed up with an organization called FIRST, for Inspiration and Recognition of Science and Technology, where the kids get these kits of robots that are all disassembled, and you have to put them together, rule books this big, and you have 6 weeks to do it. You have to make sure that you follow the rules explicitly, including making the shipment out by the deadline 6 weeks later, by 5 p.m. If you don't have that FedEx receipt proof that you got it out of your hands, you're out. So that's basically what we did. I partnered up with another teacher, and we got a NASA grant the first year, so that helped get the team kick-started off the ground. And we did this for a couple years. When Dr. Cameron, my partner and I, decided that there was this conference that we were being invited to go to that was being funded by the National Science Foundation. And the purpose was to educate teachers about underwater technology, like underwater robots, mining, you know, all the different things that they would do underwater. So they put us in this workshop with a bunch of other teachers in groups of four, and we had to build these robots and then compete at the end of the week, hopefully giving us the flavor of, you know, what it's like to do. So we would go back to the schools and tell our kids, hey, you guys got to do this underwater robotics competition. And the organization that hosts that is out of Santa Barbara, and it's called MATE, Marine Advanced Technology Education. So we basically formed our team. We got a group of kids together. Some of them were on the robotics team. Some of them were on the, or in my marine science class that I teach in my normal, regular day job. And we started doing a little research on underwater robots. We actually visited different manufacturers. The picture you see here is Seabotics out in San Diego. And the kids got to talk directly to the engineers to see, you know, well, how do you do this? Or what happens when this happens? And, you know, where do you put the batteries? All the different kinds of questions that kids would want to ask if they had a chance to. And of course, we had to raise some funding for this as well, but this was kind of a little side project for us. You know, we were looking at this to go to the event and kind of see what it's like so we can come back the next year and actually seriously compete. So we entered the event. There were two categories that we could pick, and one was a high school level, and the other one was a university level, and you can pick which one you wanted to compete in. So we thought about this and thought, you know, wouldn't it be cool if we can enter in the high school category? I mean, excuse me, the university category, and then beat at least one university, maybe two. But if we were in the high school category, you know, it wouldn't be as dramatic if we were third or second or whatever. So we thought we'd go ahead and try that, because if you got last place, it's not as embarrassing at the high school, at the university level. So it's a way for us to kind of save face. So at the event, little by little, we started seeing signs that, you know, we're not doing as bad as we thought. We're watching robot after robot go underwater and sink to the bottom, and we know that we don't think that was what was supposed to happen because they're not moving anymore. And we can see the frustration on their faces, you know, and pulling out the hair and everything. So as it turned out, the first day was the underwater part of the competition. There was also a technical writing part that had to be evaluated and an oral presentation. So at the conclusion of the underwater section, we found ourselves in third place. So we were ecstatic. Here we are, you know, Cape Fear Community College was second and MIT was third. I mean, God, we're just like one place away from MIT. That's fantastic. So as it turns out, we're at the ceremony and one of the first awards that given out was the judges award. And so they gave the judges award. And Some people at our table thought, well, this is what they call the pity award, because you guys didn't really get anything else, so we're going to make sure you go home with something, so here's the judge's award. Turns out we think we know what the judge's award was for, but I'll tell you about that later. The other award we won was a design elegance award, and this we thought was kind of cool because we were the only team that had all our wires inside of our frame so that virtually none of the wires were exposed. So we were looking at, you know, we understood that award. Then the next one kind of really surprised us, and that was the Technical Writing Award. I never thought that we'd be able to outwrite students from MIT. So we started getting a little suspicious that, hey, we got a really good chance of being, you know, one of the top two or three teams here. Well, when they announced the awards and they announced MIT as second place, we were all, you know, scared to death to say anything because we didn't know what was going to happen next. Either we were totally wrong, but it didn't look like it from the results of the awards that we were collecting. But it ended up, we ended up winning the whole competition. So when they added all the points together, Carl Hayden High School was the number one robotics team at the university level at this competition. Unlike the ability for you guys to understand that by clapping, the media gave us zero response. No newspapers, no articles, no interviews, no TV, no nothing. 8 months later, we get an email from a writer from Wired Magazine, Josh Davis. I didn't even know what Wired Magazine was. And he said, is this true that you beat MIT? And I said, well, yeah, here's the results, here's the website. He says, okay, I'm coming down, don't talk to anybody, and you know, we'll investigate this a little further. So after his article comes out in Wired Magazine, everybody wants to talk to us. Hollywood producers, Reader's Digest, Nightline, Warner Brothers, you know. So the media got out, just went crazy. But it was because of one other aspect of the competition, and it's because in the article he mentioned that they were all four undocumented. So we kind of figured, well, okay, beating MIT wasn't enough, but if you beat them with undocumented kids, you get in the news. So we had to go back second and third year to see if this was a fluke or, you know, to prove that we really could hold our own. And by now, there was a lot of publicity about the competition and the undocumented kids. And so we knew there was going to be maybe a little bit of prejudice going into the competition. And we were sort of right, because when we got the results, because they hand you the results of the score sheet, for the oral presentation and the technical writing, we got, from one judge, the highest score out of everybody in the entire competition and the lowest score out of everyone in the competition. I mean, I've never really taken a statistics class, but I kind of don't understand how you could possibly be the best and the worst in the same competition. Needless to say, overall, we finished second place and the following year, third place. So for 3 years in a row, we finished in the top three, but all 3 years beating MIT. And we never meant to go out and start beating up on MIT. It just turned out that way. So they then wanted to move their competition to Canada. And we can't prove why, but we suspect maybe it's because of the publicity that we were generating. So we figured the only competition we're going to be able to be in is if we host one, because there's no other competitions. So with the support from the people in Arizona and our robotics community, we were able to pull together enough funding to put on the National Underwater Robotics Challenge, or NURC. We formed an organization called APACE, Arizona Promoters of Applied Science and Education, for the purpose of helping Arizona become a focal point in STEM education, extracurricular STEM. So how could they do it? How could students from an inner city school do it, despite all the things that were against them? I'm going to try to explain that in the next set of slides. One is you got to remove the obstacles. A lot of our kids have financial obstacles, family obstacles, transportation obstacles. So when an opportunity arises, sometimes, you know, you have to reach into your pocket and say, okay, look, I'll buy those nuts and bolts. Don't worry about it. We'll go on. We don't want to keep that from holding us up. Or, you know, sometimes it might be when we're going someplace, they don't have, you know, money to eat lunch. And so sometimes you have to bail them out with that. But the idea was to take out the obstacles so they didn't have any reason to say, well, I can't do this, you know. So removing the obstacles was key. You had to get that. And they also can then see that they can have success. They can actually see the light at the tunnel, at the end of the tunnel, and they crave it because they're not used to having a lot of success. They're used to constantly being disappointed or having a reason not to finish. The other thing that was really key to this is, and this was accidental because I, by trade, I'm not an engineer, and neither is Dr. Cameron. We kind of stumbled into this, so we didn't really have any preconceptions. The kids didn't have any preconceptions. So every time we had an idea that we wanted to test out, we actually would do it. Or if someone said, hey, you know, you can't have control signals go 100 feet in a tether because it just won't travel that far. So we said, okay, let's make it and find out if it does or not. So we did one at 50 feet, it worked. We did one for 100 feet, it worked. It goes, oh, well, these experts are wrong. So we had 100 feet of tether, and we wanted to make sure that we had an advantage. And one of the advantages was not having to put the batteries on the surface. We wanted the batteries on the robot because then the number of cables and the size of the cables for all the batteries would be the size of my pinky instead of a whole clump of cables like this. So you can imagine trying to swim in a swimming pool and you have a hose connected to you as opposed to maybe a hair, you know. The idea is to reduce any resistance. So that's one of the advantages we had is we didn't have any preconceptions. Hands-on trial and error, that's basically what, you know, we were talking about just a second ago. You have to get them actually trying it and prove it to you that it doesn't work, or prove how another way might work. And sometimes you're getting a little bit of debates about that, but the idea was to make them try it. Don't just talk about it, do it. This one is kind of interesting because I use this a lot when I talk to my other classes as well, because sometimes they expect teaching to be the same that they have in a lot of their other classes, where the teacher stands up in front, gives out all this information, and then they hand out a test and say, okay, tell me everything I just told you. Well, what I do, I say, here's the problem, there's the internet, go find it. And the other part of that too is if Dr. Cameron and I are talking about something, or I'm talking with any of the experts that we're dealing with, they're looking at how we're finding out the information, because I don't have all the answers. You know, we have to go out and find the information, so we're modeling how to learn. And we think that's more important, because no matter what subject you're in, if you know how to find the information or how to get it by talking to people, then you can get that information. Not having to memorize it and spit it back out on a test is something that, you know, we're really pushing. So the other thing you have to look at is the defeatist attitude. Having not been in a position of them being in a winning role, you know, always expecting when they go to a competition that they're going to win, I liken it to this example. You know, you go, you guys don't just go up to the starting line and go, okay, I'm going to go for fifth place. You know, everybody that steps up in a competition, whether it's basketball, football, a race, or whatever, everyone thinks they can win. And if you don't have that attitude, it's not going to happen. So you have to go to these competitions with the idea that, hey, we're gonna do the best we can, and if you fail, what'd you get? Second place as opposed to eighth place? So the idea is if you don't make the goal you were gonna make, if you shoot high, you'll still end up higher than when you would have been if you would have shot for fifth place to begin with. So minimizing weaknesses and maximizing strengths. This is another one that's kind of interesting too, because we don't have machine shop at our school. So how do we manufacture all these things that we need? You know, here's the answer, don't. If you don't have that capability, don't do it. What do you have a capability to do? Well, there's Lowe's and Home Depot right there, you know? Or if you have somebody that can machine something for you, you beg them and say, look, we need this O-ring groove cut, I'll give you a can of six-pack of pop and some pizza, we need this part done. If you don't have those abilities, emphasize what you do. So don't try to do all the things you can. And we see a lot of teams that show up that are trying to do 10 or 12 different things all at once, all these new innovations, and then they get to the competition and their robot invariably fails because they didn't learn how to do one or two things really good and add on one or two things after that. So that's another thing we emphasize is try to, you know, use the things that you know you can get a hold of and you can demonstrate readily rather than trying to do the things that are too far-fetched. And determination beats ability. This is where I think the judge's special award is going to come back in. The kids had a solution to a problem that we had, and this was our electronics housing on top of our robot had a little leak. And the conversation came up that, well, you know, diapers have this absorbent material, and we could use that. And someone said, well, you know, tampons do too. And then someone said, well, you know, they make these really small tampons. They call them OB. And you can fit them in all the little spaces we have. So needless to say, the night before the competition, we were in the hotel room, four male teenagers and two adult males, and we're testing how much water one tampon can hold. It turns out that one tampon can hold a Dixie cup full of water. So that's what we were able to figure out by determination. The flat world. If you guys haven't read this book, you should. This will really give you a perspective of where we are as far as competing with the rest of the world. It's the ability for the technology to be accessible for everybody around the world equally without too much difficulty. As long as you got electricity and internet connection, you can find any information that anyone else in the world can find. And it's this that truly gave us the ability to find out everything that MIT knows. And chances are, if MIT discovered this secret, they put it on the internet, and we know it too. So the internet was key in being able to do this, and access to the people on the internet as well, you know, the different experts that we would have no way of finding out who they were and how to get a hold of them. And just as I was mentioning experts in the field, you got to have the kids talk to the people that know, because sometimes you don't know. But what you can do is facilitate that connection. So, for instance, if we call up Don Rodiker at Subotics and say, you know, how do you make this underwater thermistor so we can measure the temperature? And he starts explaining it to me, and I say, wait a second, speakerphone. And now the whole class of the robotics kids are listening. You're now talking to the class. So they're learning directly from the expert, a person who does this for a living every day rather than someone who could just guess, maybe, I don't know. So real-world problem solving. This is the thing for me, and I think it means the same for everyone else too, is how many times have you been in class and the teacher will say, you know, you need to know this stuff because one day you might need it? And I'm like, well, if I try hard, can I figure out how to not need it? You know? I can see how kids are thinking that, because they look at me every day when you know, I'm telling them this is stuff you gotta know. So the way to make it feel like it's something they wanna know is make them use it. And these extracurricular competitions, you know, if they want to push another robot because they need to figure out how the gear ratios are better than another, or what do they need to do to be able to have the robot go down and not compress when it goes down to 40 feet underwater, these are calculations that actually then they really care about because it determines whether or not they're going to survive in the competition. Whereas if I would have just said, okay, class, today we're going to calculate the pressure, you know, when this piece of can aluminum is going to crush, maybe one kid might be interested. And he's, you know, the odd one out. The other thing that's really important, everyone understands the team concept, but for some reason, when teachers get involved, they forget this concept. I learned pretty early on that in order to be successful, I gotta have other teachers help me. And so that's a key factor. And if you don't know, you shouldn't be embarrassed or afraid or whatever to say, look, I don't know, but let's go find out. The partner really helps too, because there's days when I don't feel motivated because there's something wrong, either in my personal life or just I'm just really tired because I got all these great things I got to grade and I don't have time to do what I really want to do or whatever. If you have another teacher there, sometimes they can pull the weight for that, so that really helps out. The kids do this instinctively. Anybody that's on the team does this instinctively, but for some reason the teachers kind of forget that a little bit. So don't do it alone. I know this one's going to sound funny, but there is no secret. The only way to go out there and be successful is you got to practice. And you'd be surprised at how many of these competitions, the first time the robot's going in the water or the first time the robot's being tested is at the competition. So it's critical that you go, you know what? I know these eight other things you want to do with the robot. Forget about that. Let's do the four and get it done now. So then when you go to the competition, you have something that's working. And then maybe you can add on one or two things. But there are teams that think totally the opposite. And we think that's probably MIT's problem, but we're not sure. The proof is in the pudding. Basically, from that time on, we've had success with our robotics program, and it's gone on for year after year after year. We've won the Chairman's Award at the International first robotics competition. So this isn't something that was one-off. This is something that's been proven. I invite you to check our websites out and look up all the different YouTube videos. We've got hundreds of them, of all the different things that we've done. And I thank you very much for your time. Thank you.